Welcome to the old school preaching of VHS, old school, old lamb, word of God. Again, guys, we're in chapter 19, the wedding supper of the lamb. Remember, the marriage is a marvelous picture of the joining between Christ and the church. Remember, Jesus Christ died for that we can have access to God the Father. We're going to marry the Lord. You know, he is our high priest. You know, remember, the bride occupies a unique relationship with Christ. Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. Remember, the man and the woman become one. God and the church, they get married and they become one. So, guys, talking about the book of Revelation chapter 19, this is what we see, guys. This is how awesome it is. You know, in Revelation chapter 19, when the multitude sings out a second time, a picture of smoke rising from the battle is a sign of the permanence of the destruction. Then for the final time in Revelation, the 24 elders, the four living creatures, and those who have been described as once closest to God's take part of the end time worship. So Revelation 19, verse 9 through 10. Today, and he said unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said to me, thou art, do not, for I am a fellow servant and thy brethren, and have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Now, the angel that was with John, he bowed down to worship the angel in heaven. He's like, hey, don't do that. You know, the angel's word makes several things clear. Angels are not to be worshipped. Angels are fellow servants with Christians in bearing the witness of Jesus. And the testimony about Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So the next verse, guys, what we're going to see is the eyes of the Lord, eyes of fire. Pastor McGee says this, hear me carefully now. The marriage of the Lamb will take place in heaven, but the marriage supper will take place upon the earth. Now, listen to what he says. The marriage of the Lamb will take place in heaven. Now, the supper is going to be take on earth. So I know when I got married, I went over here to on Stewart. I got married right there at the Victory Outreach. That became a Victory Outreach too. At the Teen Challenge church building. And then I got married and the reception was in Hollister. So when we get married in heaven, the reception is going to be on earth. I don't know if you ever seen that, but that's what the Bible here is saying. But the marriage supper will be placed here on earth. The picture of this is in Matthew chapter 25, verse 1 through 3, which is the parable of the 10 virgins. You see, the virgins are not the bride. Christ was only one bride, and that is the church. The bridegroom will return to the earth for the marriage supper. He will return not only to judge the earth, but to have a marriage supper, which the 10 virgins are expecting to attend. So that verse where there was five virgins, wise virgins, and five not so wise who, you know, they would say, oh, go out there and buy yourself the oil. According to Pastor McGee, this is not even a reference, which most pastors use this as a reference to being ready to when the Lord comes. Now, is the Lord going to marry five of them? Of course not. So Pastor McGee is opening up the scriptures to show you that the bridegroom will return to the earth for the marriage supper. He will return not only to judge the earth, but to have a marriage supper, which the 10 virgins are expecting to attend. Another picture of the same scene is given in Psalm 45. In this psalm, Christ is seen coming as king. We are not told who she is, but the queen is the king's daughters. Are among thy honorable women. Upon thy right hand did stand the queen of gold of Ophir. Psalm 45:9. I believe this is a symbol or a type of the church. guests are present, and the daughter of Tyre shall be there with a gift. Even the rich among the people shall entreat thy favor. The marriage supper will take place on earth. Both Israelis and Gentiles who enter the millennium are invited guests. The marriage supper is evidentially the millennium. That's a thousand-year reign. You talk about a long supper. This is going to be a long one. At the end of the millennium, the church is still seen as the bride. Imagine a honeymoon that lasts 1,000 years. Yet that is only the beginning. What joy, what ecstasy. The angels puts God's seal on the scene, for these are the true words of God. So again, guys, the Bible's telling us here concerning the wedding supper of the Lamb that we're going to get married in heaven, and we're going to come back to earth, and really it's going to be a 1,000-year party. That's what Pastor McGee is saying. That sounds pretty cool to me. New body, new kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, right? So again, guys, this is more insight from the Word of God. You know, we always think we're going to be, a lot of Christians believe that when they die, they're just going to be in heaven for all eternity. That's not what the Bible teaches. We're going to rule and reign, Revelation 19:14. We come back with the earth. We come back with the Lord to the earth. And then the wedding supper, the marriage is in heaven, but remember, the wedding supper is on earth. Again, this is a great picture. And even God says that these are the true words of God. And then he goes on to say, after acting as a scribe for the scene, John feels compelled to worship the angelic messenger. However, he is restrained from doing so. The angel is but a creature. Only God is to be worshipped. What a rebuke to Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet, who wanted to be worshipped. And there is many folks in our day who have the same desire. After the marriage of the Lamb in heaven, the next great event is the return of Christ to the earth. My friend, the King is coming, but he will not come until the church has been raptured and after the earth is undergone the great tribulation. Now when he comes to the earth, his bride will be with him, and the marriage supper will be here on earth, as we have seen. Oh, my friend, what a glorious day is ahead of us. If we could just get our eyes off the muck and mire of this earth and into the things that are of the Lord and the things that are eternal. Okay, guys. That was pretty good insight, huh? That was pretty good insight. Okay, guys. This is from the book of Leviticus, chapter 23, verse 33 to 34. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of this seventh month shall be the feast of tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord. On the day of atonement, the nation confessed their sins and afflicted their souls. The result, a party 5 days later at the feast of tabernacles, five being the number of grace. Every morning during the Feast of Tabernacles, the priests would divide into two processionals. One group would go directly east to the valley of Kidron and gather willow, palm, myrtle, and citrus branches to pass out to the people and to lay in the country yard of the temple where sacrifices were made. The second group of priests would go south to the pool of Shalom, carrying a golden pitcher, which they would dip into the water. Both companies of priests, who's carrying the branches and those carrying the water, would meet at the temple, where the water was poured out from the pitcher before the altar as a reminder of God's provision to water for them during the wilderness wanderings. On the eighth day, the great feast, the priests would go to the pool of Shalom, but they would return with an empty pitcher, acknowledging the fact that because they were now in the promised land, they were no longer need for supernatural provision of water. As they did, the priests would pray this prayer. This would be the prayer of the priests. Thus says the Lord that made thee and formed thee from thy womb, which will help thee. Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and thou, Jerusalem, Jesurun, whom I have chosen. I will pour water upon him with that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thy offspring, and they will spring up as among the grass, as willows by the waters and carries. This is the book of Isaiah. Kibalepa! Chapter 44, verse 2 through 4. My dad. My mom. What are you guys doing? Oh. Why would they read this passage? Because they understood that Isaiah 44 was a prophecy of the pouring out of the Spirit that would transpire only when the Messiah came to their land. The year is approximately 32 AD. On the day of the feast, everyone watched as the processional returned from the pool of Siloam, poured out the empty pitcher, and prayed for the Messiah to come. Then a young 33-year-old rabbi from Galilee shouts out, "If any man thirsts, let him come unto me and drink. Out of the belly shall flow rivers of living water." John chapter 7, verse 37 through 38. Thereby presenting himself as the Messiah and offering the living water, the rain of the Holy Spirit. But Jesus' declaration was not yet complete. Every night during the Feast of Tabernacles, the celebration of illumination took place on the Temple Mount. In this celebration, four huge menorahs with wicks made of priests' robes, which had been worn out, were lit and shined so brightly that light would be seen 100 miles away. At the end of the feast, the menorahs would be extinguished, not to be wilt until the following year. John tells us that it was on that day after the Feast of Tabernacles, the day after the menorahs were extinguished, that Jesus declared, "I am the light of the world," John chapter 8, verse 12, "and the true light which would never be extinguished." Don't lose sight of the fact that the Lord's coming is near, gang. In the meantime, drink deeply of the water of His Spirit and illuminate your life, not from the pillar of fire or a huge menorah, which was used and then extinguished, but by the presence and promises of the One who will never leave you nor forsake you, and will be with you not only daily, but to the end of time. So again, guys, I hope you're encouraged and blessed by today's message. Remember, guys, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto me, "These are the true sayings of God." And I felt at the feet, says again, Apostle John. And he said unto me, "Thou art due not worship me." You know, guys, we shouldn't worship anything other than God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Nothing else. Nada más. That's it. And I hope, guys, what a joy it's going to be, not only to be raptured, but to go into heaven and to come back with the Lord to the wedding and come down to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And Pastor McGee says it's going to be a 1,000-year party. Until the end, until they revolt against God again. Because, you know, the generations that are going to be born in the millennium reign, they're not going to see what we're going to see as we head into the tribulation. See, they're born after the tribulation. So there's people going to be born after the tribulation, guys. And they're going to rebel against God, too. Just like everybody right now is rebelling against God, because they don't know. But God is going to send the two witnesses. God is going to send the 144,000. God is going to send His word. God is going to send angels in heaven proclaiming the everlasting gospel in the sky. God, guys, these are what we call Bible stories coming to life. You know, we're all going to be part of a real Bible story very soon. And I hope you get born again and you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior before the time of terrible times the Bible predicts will come upon the whole world. And it came upon the whole world. Where can you go? This is God doing it. You have a choice. God gives each one of us free will, and hopefully you use that will. For the throne. No doctrine in the whole world of God has more excited the hatred of mankind than the truth of the absolute sovereignty of God. And behold, there was a man who had a withered hand. And they asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? And they might accuse him. No matter what Jesus did, guys, they didn't like him. And they still don't like him today. And he's a good guy. He's a good guy. He's a great guy. He's a high priest. He's our advocate before our Father. And again, guys, Jesus said, then he said unto them, what man is there among you who has one sheep, and if it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will he not lay hold of it and lift it out? Guys, God wants to lift you out of the pit you're in now. Being born spiritually dead, you need to have a relationship with God. You need to apply God's word into your life and grow. And you know what? You don't want to get into the tribulation, and at best, you're just a baby in Christ. Now, I don't know when the tribulation is. I don't know when I know that when the tribulation starts. The Antichrist makes a peace, 7-year peace treaty with Israel. That's when it starts. But hopefully you get raptured. And if you're left behind, just remember this, guys. You still have a choice. Don't take the mark of the beast. By default, if you don't take the mark of the beast, you're choosing the Lord. Now, by default, if you take the mark of the beast, you're rejecting the Lord. So understand that you have a choice. It's pretty much take the mark or don't take the mark in your right hand and in your forehead. It is coming, guys. It's a Bible story coming to you to a new theater near you. May the Lord bless you, be girded, be strengthened. The Lord is coming. He's coming quickly, and his reward is with him.